The Dyson vacuum cleaner company is building this gigantic mechanized greenhouse in the UK to grow strawberries. And as a permaculture urbanist, it occurred to me to ask three questions. First of all, is this productive? Second, is it good for the planet? And third, what could they build instead? Welcome to Edenicity, best practices for sustainably abundant cities. Okay, disclaimer, I'm a huge Dyson fan. I loved their original bagless vacuum cleaner because I hated buying expensive proprietary vacuum cleaner bags, especially since for me that usually meant pedaling all over a giant car-infested city searching for the right brand of bag to match whatever kind of vacuum cleaner I had. Dyson's original advertising slogan was, "Say goodbye to the bag." And yes, I was an early adopter. That's my vacuum cleaner right there. And I had it for nearly two decades before, unfortunately, a plumber friend of mine mistook it for a shop vac and I found it filled with water. I also appreciate that James Dyson is an academically trained artist, bringing insights to industrial design that are not commonly found in engineering. That said, the robotic strawberry growing greenhouse has to be just about the most propeller-headed thing I've seen all year. With 24-meter, 78-foot long hydroponic trays, 500-kilogram or 1,100-pound wheels spinning the whole thing, sensor-activated, spectrum-optimized LED lights, ultraviolet mold treatment bots, experimental harvest bots, and incredible amounts of inputs in the form of energy to mine and build the structures, energy for lights, sensors, and machinery, all the technology it takes to handle, pack, store, and transport strawberries, and the infrastructure to move their enormous workforce on and off the worksite, all for a yield of 2.5 times more strawberries per hectare than the next best approach. But I really wish I'd had a chance to sit down with his team before the start of this project. It's in the wrong paradigm. Our existence, after all, spans two paradigms, the object paradigm and the life paradigm. Objects are consumed. If I cut a little piece off of my glasses, for example, that piece does not regrow. And I can't stick that little chunk in the ground and have more glasses later on. Life is abundant in a way that objects are simply not. So the world of objects is the world of ownership of scarce resources that we must compete for. And this ultimately results in the concept of exclusive use or entitlement. Whereas the life paradigm involves gifts, cooperation, and a natural sense of gratitude. For example, life, more often than not, is layered. It stacks the land with gifts that make the land itself more habitable to all of the life that shares it. The tragedy of industrial agriculture is that it treats life as objects and only values one crop at a time. I've shown in many other episodes how, when we cut down a layered forest to make room for single crops, we are literally removing all but one layer of living biomass. And that one layer that remains has about 2% of the biomass that you'll find in, for example, a forest. Our agriculture, and especially our open grazing, now occupies more than 50% of the land, and, according to a recent biomass inventory, has wiped out half the life of the planet. Not a coincidence. Even in the soil, modern agriculture has caused a 99% loss of microbial species, resulting in rapid leaching of nutrients and loss of soil structure, meaning erosion. Now, that said, is there any economic case to be made for layered agriculture, whatever that would be? Well, yes, in fact, there is. In a prior episode, I showed that we can grow coffee in either the life paradigm or the object paradigm. Now, the basic fact of coffee is that it's an understory plant. But when you grow it in the object paradigm, in the open sun, in a plantation with nothing else around, it will give you twice as many coffee berries. But doing so shortens its life and requires enormous inputs of water and chemicals. But in the life paradigm, we can grow coffee where it wants to be, in the understory, where it lives 60 years. In that environment, we still have inputs, but in this case, it's living beings, the overstory trees, the birds that help to rid the coffee of the coffee berry borer, the animals that can run through the forest floor that provide manure and fertilizer, and the many foods that you can get from the overstory trees, including macadamia nuts, guava, mango, and bananas. Now, it is true that in the shade, the yield of coffee is half as much. Now, it does take more labor to harvest all of that, but at the end of the day, the net returns of shade-grown coffee, combined with all of the other yields when you grow it this way, are 3.5 times higher than in the object paradigm. And this compares very favorably to the factor of 2.5 that Dyson states in their video, all with minimal additional inputs of technology and energy. Now, layered agriculture is not new by any means. The ancient Romans had it in 750 BC when layered family gardens increased soil fertility so much that they called it cultura promiscua. Unfortunately for Rome, later large-scale plantation agriculture cut their soil fertility by 92%. But Rome is hardly the earliest example of successful layered agriculture. In his 1906 book, Farmers of 40 Centuries, F.H. King traveled through several Asian countries documenting the layered family gardening and family farming that had been in place for over 4,000 years. And even that's not the earliest. Recent research has found that over 10,000 years ago, early humans planted forest islands in Amazonia's grasslands, as reported in Discover magazine back in 2020. Now, the key in all cases of traditional layered agriculture is that people live close to their food sources. And this makes sense because we co-evolved with them. We have many, many sensory feedbacks with the system of food that we depend on, to the extent that just contact with soil has been shown to have antidepressive qualities. And that smell of approaching rain, again, that's soil microbes responding to the moisture. We can smell that down to several parts per billion, all of which led me to wonder if we could merge permaculture, which is applied ecology or basically layered agriculture, with urbanism, which is making cities more livable via car-free, transit-oriented, mixed-use cities that produce their own food and energy. In other words, what can we do to bring layered food production into the city? And that would be the main challenge I would pose for Dyson. What could Dyson do for Edenicity? Well, I think their vacuum cleaners give a really great clue. They excel at small-scale mechanization, so I picture their inventiveness being really helpful in the realm of small-scale, multi-crop mechanization. This would be things like compact transplanters and combines for the raised beds that you might find in rooftop gardens, or refinements on inventions like this hand-cranked rice planter shown in the video linked here. I imagine that nimble, perhaps semi-robotic, fruit and nut harvesters would allow us to grow to full height tree crops that are currently grown mainly on dwarfing rootstock. They could also probably do very sophisticated compost management through temperature, moisture, and CO2 sensors, and active controls for water harvesting. For example, in a city, if you have downspout diverters from rooftops, putting an active control in there could save your pipes from experiencing ice plugs in a sudden freeze. Because in the life paradigm, it's not about improving the yield of any one crop. It's about bringing Earth back to life, especially where most of us live, especially in the city. If you're curious to learn more about Edenicity, you can have a look at these videos here, or check out the land use concept that I've linked in the description. And thanks so much to the patrons for helping support this channel. It really means a lot to me. Take care, stay green, see you next time.